may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Words, words, words. We all have to have them in life. We all have many of them. And there's many words that we certainly despise, but we just can't live without words. Certainly words are a tool of my trade. They are the capital of my livelihood. As a pastor, I'm already automatically prepared to have to say something on all occasions. And people sometimes expect me to come up with exactly the right words, no matter what the situation. No less so that in the morning time, on Sundays when we gather, I'm expected to say something, hopefully of value, hopefully that leads us into a place of service and discipleship. There are words in this sermon this morning, and as Microsoft Word Count told me, there are 1,581 words. So be prepared. Now, how would we worship if it weren't for words, words to say, words to sing, words that we can use in our litanies, reading of the scriptures, the prayers, the songs, and the hymns, all of which are intended to put words in our mouths, hopefully holy words. Some of them old, some of them familiar, some of them comfortable. But also some of these words relatively new, maybe unfamiliar, and possibly a bit unsettling. Words are what God has to shape and mold our lives, discipline us into deeper and grateful servanthood as followers of Jesus Christ. You know, we wouldn't be here if it weren't for words. Our first book in the Bible, Genesis, starts out that way. God spoke, and all things in creation came into being. We're not quite sure who heard those words, but God spoke creation, we say. And at the end of all the days, God says what? Ah, this is good. This is very good. God is loved with words. They bring creation itself into being. They bring us into being. This point's carried on in the poetry of Psalm 19 we used as our call to worship this morning. I love the poetry in that, particularly in that line that speaks to the wonder. As you can see, the psalmist looking up at the sky, probably at night, and all the stars, planets out there. He comes up with this wonderful saying. Without speech, without words, without even an audible voice, their cry echoes throughout the entire world. Their message reaches the ends of the world. In other words, the heavens are always talking. In their own way, we are to be listening to what they may be saying. Maybe some of you are aware that we do as a country have these incredible satellites that are focused up into the heavens, going 24 hours a day, 365 days out of the year, listening. That's all they're doing, listening. Now so far, all we get is static. Sometimes that's all you get in the sanctuary. But they're listening. Something's going on out there. We're expecting that we may someday hear. So all around us, words, even in silence. Well, certainly we call the scriptures the spirit-inspired word of God. For here, when we turn to the scriptures, we expect as a congregation that as we join together in faith and listen to the words and what's between the lines in these words, that indeed we can still hear God speaking. Not as it was of old, but God speaking right now, in this place, in this moment. We also describe Jesus as what? The Word of God made flesh, John says. The Word of God, flesh and dwelling among us, full of grace, mercy, the incarnate Word. So I need us to say more about the reality that we know already that words have power. We know that words can heal and create. They can calm, excite, inform, compel, transform, and even restrain us. But we also know painfully that words can hurt. They can divide, crush, deceive, revolt, and even kill others. So shaping thoughts into words is an art form. Speaking and writing are crafts which take much practice and development. For words can open to us the pathway to understanding and beauty and truth. They can move us to form unions and communions, bonds that last forever. They can inspire us to discover new ways of being in relationship with God's creation and with one another. Words are the way that we grow and the way that we pray, expanding our horizons within the redeeming love and justice, the amazing grace and mercy of our God. And so the issue before us this morning with faith is that about our words. What words are we using? And how do we know when we should speak? And how should we know the times that we should not speak and remain silent? There are words that are acceptable to our Lord. So conversely, there must be words coming out of our mind and mouth that aren't acceptable to God. Well, this certainly is a timely topic, isn't it? Not in the midst of a presidential campaign season. Talk about a lot of words. Two conventions, hour upon hour of campaign commercials, sound bites and back bites, expensive words. For me, November 6th can't come soon enough. Recently saw a cartoon showed a politician standing before a podium making a disclaimer relative to some prior comment that he had made, and he said, "I regret that my poor choice of words caused some people to understand exactly what I was saying." I lay before you this morning this expression, "Be impeccable with your word." The saying comes from what is known as the Four Agreements, that come from a book written by Don Miguel Ruiz, based on Toltec, Aztec wisdom. He suggests that we would start each day with our minds focused on these four practices, or agreements as he calls them. First, that we would be impeccable with our word. That we wouldn't take anything personally. That we wouldn't make any assumptions. And fourth, that we would do our best. Now that ought to keep us busy for the day. I keep a copy of those four at my desk and hopefully do become mindful of them occasionally, but I think they probably should be on a plaque that I wear around my chest. So if I'm not following, you can point out, wait a minute, number three there. Or better yet, I probably should have them inscribed on my lenses. Because you have to keep these things before you to know what is good and helpful in the way that you speak. And listen and do. Be impeccable with your word. It means choosing words wisely. It means only using words that heal and help and lead. It means that we think before we speak. It means that we say only what we mean. And with our words, we will never do any harm. I think this is the counsel that we hear in the James, as he's trying to be helpful in disciplining the church, the way that we use our tongues and the words that come forth from them. He most pointedly makes the point that we have to be extremely careful how we use these tongues, this small rudder, he says, that actually can change the course of history. These tongues which can set the world on fire, either for good or for evil. These tongues which can praise God, but at the same time we know have also cursed the very men and women that are created in God's image. Well, we certainly heard and saw more than enough painful evidence of the kind of incendiary talk in our recent days, and it's still going on. Hate speech here and there. A despicable and distorted video sets of embassies ablaze, leading to death and mayhem. Accusations flying back and forth, critics and commentators lobbying charges and countercharges back and forth at each other, provocative rhetoric, with everyone standing their personal ground, everyone certain of their own veracity, and all the while struggling with the word like a pathogen. Freedom of speech. Maybe as Christians, we don't have as much as others. We are called to speak in a particular way. And it's the freedom not to say that which is hurtful and untrue. And so maybe we ought to take an inventory of the words that we used this past week. Maybe if you have a spouse, you ask that person, how did I do last week with my words? Or somebody close to you in your family, in a relationship, let us know what they heard. As James asserts, we're able to make tame tigers, but we haven't learned how to tame the tongue. That doesn't mean we're not supposed to make every effort prayerfully and helping each other in the church to be impeccable with our words. A lesson from Mark's gospel, I believe, also is a case study in words. There's many ways you can read this text, but overlaying James' text upon it, I want to hear this text in this way. We hear the power of words to inform and to inspire. We hear the power of words to enlighten and to clarify, but also their power to correct and confirm. First of all, in the text of Mark and Peter's confession, we hear words to inform. Jesus wants to know what's going on the street. What's the word out there on the street? How is my ministry being perceived? What are people seeing and hearing in what I've been about? Sounds very familiar, doesn't it? We're always taking polls. I need to focus groups. What do other people think? Where are they now? How are they going to vote? Will they buy? So Jesus does the same thing. And so the disciples apparently went out, took a poll, and so they came back and they said, well, 52% say that you're a heck of a lot like John the Baptist. 37% checked off Elijah. You appear to be that one in the scriptures that some expect to return before the Messianic age. And 11% checked, just one of the other prophets, like all those who have gone before. Words inform what's going on, but that's never enough. Secondly, words clarify. Or what Jesus really wanted to know was not what's going on the street so much, but what was going on within the disciples. And so he turns to the disciples and he says to them, who do you say that I am? This is the most important question, maybe of faith today, for us to answer, and that is, who is Jesus Christ to us? How do we understand? What does he matter to me? And why does that matter in my life today and in this world? Not using worn out cliches, not words of the church that we're expected to say, but in our heart. What is the connection? What is the word? The connection to Jesus Christ. Thirdly, words proclaim. We use words to say what is important to us, what is most significant. What is the way that we will live? We don't know if any of the other disciples spoke up when Jesus asked the question about who do you say I am, or how long it took for anyone to respond. Sometimes in scriptures, when we're reading them so fast, we don't allow the gaps I think they're necessary, because I think there was a meeting in time between when Jesus asked, who do you say I am, and Peter spoke. But eventually he did. And he said, you are the Messiah, meaning the anointed one of God. I have a sense also that Peter felt pretty confident in what he said. It's like the boy that put the pillar in the stone and pulled out a plum and said, oh, what a good boy am I. He thought he nailed it. I'm so sure about that, aren't we, when we hear what Jesus has to say? And Peter, along with the church then, and sometimes even now, expect the Christ to be the one who comes and settles all the arguments on the earth instantly. They thought that Jesus might bring a sudden and complete end to the evil and the violence and the division of the Roman Empire by overthrowing them and setting up a theocracy in Jerusalem. Peter said the right word, but he really didn't know what he was saying. And so words, we also find out in this text, discipline us, they correct us. Jesus, in no uncertain terms, makes it painfully clear to the disciples and to the church that in Jesus, the word Messiah means suffering for love and forgiveness. It means failing to be rejected for justice and mercy, even a painful death into a new and different life we call our resurrection. Of course, Peter thinks he needs to correct Jesus because Jesus must be having a bad day talking about suffering. So what does Peter do? He takes Jesus aside and he rebukes him. Pretty strong language. In other words, he was wanting to tell Jesus, no, that's not what we had in mind. If I'm going to be a follower, I can't be a part of all of that. And then Jesus, we know, has to then take Peter aside. Before all the other disciples, he says, what did Peter? Get behind me, Satan. You're coming up with your own ideas that are not a part of what God has for us in our worship and in our service of God. I always love the way that James Ward talks about this text. You know, he said, you know, when Jesus said to Peter, get behind me, Satan, Peter just didn't get up instantly and get behind Jesus. He says Jesus went and stood and put his back, put Peter behind. We're being corrected. Sometimes in pretty stern and direct language, where the word that will power us into greater life. Yes, God's word comes to discipline us and to turn us into God's better way. And finally, words I think we find in this text that are profound typically confound us. Jesus' words force us always to go deeper. What is perfectly clear is that the word of the mouth of Jesus always comes out with multi-layered meanings. So we need to pay attention, we need to hear, but we also need to live into the power of His Word. For His words are always working to re-script our lives, to place new and different words in our hearts, put them in our minds, but also to put those words in our mouths. So we're going to practice that. I'm taking out the Bible in front of you or next to you. Everybody needs a Bible. Turn to page 8, which is Mark 8 of the Gospels. The Gospel of Mark, page 8, the 8th chapter, 43, 44. Oh, I know we have two numbers. How can we get 8 in there? My goodness. How come nobody raised their hand before and said, oh, it's not on page 8? Well, wait, everybody will find 42, 43, 44, in that area. Mark 8. Okay, what we're going to do, we're going to read verses 34 through 37. It starts out, He called. Ready? Let us say it together. He called the crowd with His disciples and said to them, if anyone wants to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will impeccable words. So may the words of our mouth and the meditation of our hearts be accepted in God's sight, our rock